Stocks, bonds, currencies, and commodities. We look at all sorts of assets in finance, and it's tempting to fixate on their prices. But prices alone don't tell us how unpredictable or stable an investment might be. Switch from looking at prices to looking at returns, and it's a whole new story. When we plot returns, things look a bit chaotic at first, like a jumble of ups and downs. But if we put those returns into a histogram, we see a familiar shape, a bell curve. This is why we often describe returns using a normal distribution. Using this model, we can measure how much an asset tends to vary, and that variation is what we quants call volatility. That bell curve can be fully described with just two numbers. The first is the mean, the center of the curve. For daily returns, the mean is often very close to zero, some days up, some days down, but it averages out. The second number is the variance, or its square root, the standard deviation. This measures how spread out the returns are around that mean. Variance is calculated by squaring the deviations and averaging them. Then we take the square root to get standard deviation, so the units match the returns themselves. If returns are in percent, the standard deviation is also in percent. In finance, when we apply this to returns, we call it volatility. Big spread, high volatility. Small spread, low volatility. This is a common way quants measure risk. Let's see what this looks like with real numbers. Suppose we have daily returns for one stock. Step one, find the average return. That's our mean. Step two, for each day, subtract that mean and square the difference. Step three, average all those squared differences. That's the variance. Step four, take the square root. That's the standard deviation or the daily volatility. So here's our mean daily return. And this is our standard deviation. That tells us that on a typical day, the return wanders about 1% away from the average. It doesn't mean we can predict whether tomorrow will be up or down. It just tells us the scale of the movement we should expect. That's what we mean by volatility. Our volatility calculation was for the period October 1st through December 31st, 2024. That's 64 trading days or 63 daily returns. But here's the thing. Volatility depends on the number of data points you choose to include. We call this the window. To demonstrate, let's recalculate the volatility using several different windows. First, the month of December, 2024. That's 21 trading days. We've already calculated the volatility for the fourth quarter of 2024. Next, let's look at the second half of the year, 128 trading days. And finally, the full 252 trading days in the year. Each window gives a different number for the volatility. So why choose a certain window? The shorter windows are more sensitive to new information. If the market suddenly gets jumpy, a monthly volatility measure will spike almost immediately. By comparison, the longer windows are less influenced by daily changes. They smooth out those jumps, but that also means they are slow to react when conditions shift. So which window is correct? That depends on how quickly you need to respond to new information. Longer windows smooth out noise, but react slowly. Shorter windows respond faster, but come with more day-to-day variability. In the end, it's a matter of matching your volatility measure to the speed of your decision-making. Volatility is just one piece of the bigger picture of quantitative finance. If you're looking to fill the gaps in your financial education, good news, the missing link is right below. Click to learn more about our finance courses. It's the next step in your evolution from curious observer to fully fledged quant. So far, we've been looking at daily volatility because daily pricing and thus daily returns are the industry standard. But the most common unit of volatility is the annual volatility. In finance, it's the standard language that people use when they talk about how risky an investment is. So even though we calculate volatility from daily data, we usually report it on an annual basis. Let's see how we convert our daily volatility into annual volatility. The fundamental principle is that when you add up returns over multiple days, you're basically adding up a lot of daily normal distributions. If you imagine each day's returns as a random draw from a normal distribution, then stacking up 252 of those gives you the normal distribution for the year. Here's how the math works. When you combine two normal distributions, their means add together, and their variances add together. The standard deviations, however, do not simply add up. Recall the standard deviation is the square root of the variance. So the standard deviation of the combined distribution is the square root of the sum of the variances. Let's now convert each of these three measures into annual units. The annual return is 252 times the daily return. The annual variance is 252 times the daily variance. If we take the square root of both sides, we get that the annual standard deviation is the square root of 252 times the daily standard deviation. This process is what we call annualizing. If we return to our example and do this process of annualizing for each of the windows, we see the annual volatility ranges from about 13% to 20%. These are much more relatable values. Up to this point, we've only talked about the volatility of a single asset. But traders never have just a single investment. They build portfolios, collections of different assets. To measure the volatility of a portfolio, we need to move from one-dimensional statistics to a multivariate view. Think of it this way. We modeled a single asset with a normal distribution, which can be described by two numbers, the mean and standard deviation. For a portfolio with multiple assets, we now need a pair of higher dimensional measurements. A mean vector, where every component is the average return for a certain asset, and a covariance matrix. A grid that holds not only the variance of each asset, but also the covariance of each pair of assets. There's one more necessary ingredient, the weight vector. That's a list of percentages showing how much of our money we've put into each asset. For example, suppose we invest $1 million into five assets. If we assemble these five values into a vector, then divide each component by 1 million, the result is the weight vector for this portfolio. With these three ingredients, mean vector, covariance matrix, and weight vector, we can describe the risk and return of the entire portfolio. Now to put the pieces together, we have our weight vector showing how much of our portfolio is in each asset. We have the covariance matrix showing how each pair of assets moves together. The variance of the portfolio is calculated with this formula. Here, W is the weight vector and sigma is the covariance matrix. You take the transpose of the weight vector, multiply it by the covariance matrix, then multiply again by the weight vector. The result is a single number, the portfolio variance. To get the portfolio volatility, we then take the square root. This formula captures two important things at once, the volatility of each individual asset and the correlations between them. If the assets are highly correlated, meaning they tend to move together, the portfolio volatility will be close to the average of the individual volatilities. If the assets are less correlated, the volatility of the portfolio will be smaller than any one asset on its own. This is the essence of diversification, combining risky assets in a way that reduces overall risk. So portfolio volatility isn't just the sum of the individual volatilities. This grouped measure of risk depends critically on how the assets interact. And the covariance matrix is what tells us that story. In this example, we'll calculate the volatility of a simple three-stock portfolio. To do this, we'll need the weight vector and the covariance matrix. We're holding 20% Home Depot, 30% Hershey, and 50% Johnson & Johnson, all traded on the New York Stock Exchange. From this allocation, we can find our weight vector, the fraction of money in each stock. Using the daily price data, we can calculate the daily returns for each of the three stocks. The next step is to calculate the covariance matrix of these three assets' returns. Remember, this matrix shows how the returns of these stocks move together. We now have everything we need to calculate the portfolio's daily variance. Then we take the square root to find our portfolio's daily volatility. To show the benefits of diversification, let's compare the volatility of our portfolio to each of the individual stocks. For ease of comparison, let's annualize all volatility numbers. Recall the numbers along the diagonal of the covariance matrix are the variances of each of the stocks. Using these, we can take the square root to find the daily volatility, then multiply by the square root of 252 to annualize. Similarly, we will multiply the portfolio's daily volatility by the square root of 252. Now we can directly compare this portfolio's annualized volatility to the individual annualized volatilities of Home Depot, Hershey, and J&J. You'll notice that the portfolio's volatility is lower than two out of the three individual stocks. It's even approaching J&J, the lowest volatility. This highlights the benefit of diversification. Even with positively correlated assets, spreading your investment can reduce overall risk. So far, we've seen how to measure the volatility of your own portfolio using a covariance matrix and your chosen weights. But often, you want to compare your portfolio's risk to the broader market. The S&P 500 is a common benchmark for overall market returns, but we also need a standard measure for the market's volatility. That's where the VIX comes in. The VIX, officially the CBOE Volatility Index, is published by the Chicago Board Options Exchange. It's the market's forecast of annualized volatility for the S&P 500 over the next 30 days. Instead of looking backward at historical returns, the VIX looks forward, using option prices to read the market's collective expectations. By definition, the VIX is the market's estimate of annualized volatility for the S&P 500, looking ahead 30 days into the future. So when you see the VIX quoted as, say, 20, that means traders expect the S&P 500's returns to fluctuate about 20% over the next year, based on today's option prices. How does that compare with our portfolio calculation? We used historical returns to estimate past volatility. The VIX uses option prices to estimate future volatility. That's why the VIX is often called the market's fear gauge. In quiet times, it might sit near 12 or 15. In turbulent times, it can surge past 40, even spiking above 80 during crises. It's the yardstick for comparing our own risk outlook to the markets. If you wish to incorporate this measure into your investment strategy, while you can't buy the VIX directly, there are futures, options, and exchange-traded products tied to it. That makes volatility itself something investors can trade, just like stocks, bonds, or currencies. We've learned a lot about volatility, how markets jump around, how portfolios reduce risk, and how traders even bet on turbulence itself. But there's one kind of volatility we'd rather see go away, our financial volatility. If you enjoy these videos and want to help stabilize our returns, please consider supporting us on Patreon. Think of it as hedging your portfolio. A small contribution from you reduces a lot of uncertainty for us. Support Socratica on Patreon because, unlike markets, our videos should not be this volatile.